comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Man, that's terrific. Great job. Children's and youth choirs both. It is not Palm Sunday if we don't hear from the kiddos. So thank you for being here. Families, thank you for having them involved in our music ministries. If I don't know you, my name's Chris Dowd. I'm the senior pastor here at Christ United, and it is wonderful to be worshiping together on a beautiful April Sunday morning. This is also the sixth Sunday in the season of Lent, and we are very near to our celebration of Easter. We have lots of wonderful things planned in worship for today. Before we get to those, I have a couple of announcements just to make sure you're all aware of the schedule for this coming week. The first is Maundy Thursday. That's on Thursday, obviously, at 7 p.m. That's a service of Holy Communion here in the sanctuary that commemorates Christ's last supper with his disciples. Then the next day, Good Friday, we have two worship services at 6 p.m. in Underwood Hall. We have a service that's really designed for children and their families. And then at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary, we have the traditional service of darkness, which is a beautiful and moving service. If you're able to be here, you're going to want to be here for that. Then next Sunday, we have a modified schedule for Easter Sunday. 7 a.m., we have a just after sunrise service, and that's going to be in the courtyard to your right where the fountain is near the columbarium. That's going to be led by our modern worship team. And then here in the sanctuary we have three worship services, and it is a different schedule. If you're normally 11 o'clock folk, you're good. I would get here early because there'll be a lot of people here. We have 8 a.m., 9:30 a.m., and 11 a.m. All three of those services will have the choir and an orchestra, and it's going to be awesome. And then if you would like to, here's what I'd recommend. I'd recommend coming at 7 because that's going to be great. Sticking around for 8, you're going to love it so much, you're going to want to be here for 9:30, and then you're going to want to hear what Stephanie has to say about Easter at 11 o'clock in the modern service in Underwood Hall. So, full morning planned. It is great to see you all this morning. Let us rise in body or in spirit as we call ourselves to worship.
Good morning. I'm Reagan Gilliland, pastor of Adult Discipleship here at Christ United, and I invite you to join me in the call to worship. We come to prepare for the holiest of weeks. We will journey through praise with joy on our lips. We will travel through betrayal and death, cradling hope deep in our hearts. Jesus leads us through this week, and we will follow, for he is the life we long for and the word who sustains us. We wave palm branches in anticipation. We lay our love before him to cushion his walk. Setting aside all power, glory, and might, he comes, modeling humility and obedience for all of us. Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is the one who brings us the kingdom of God. Amen.
I invite you to remain standing as we join together in our opening hymn, number 278, Hosanna, Loud Hosanna.
Good morning, I'm Mike Flynn, pastor of Care Ministries here at Christ United. Please join me now in the Apostles' Creed as we affirm our faith together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Father, and to the Son, and to the Lord.
Please be seated.
Well, this morning, if we didn't have enough cute kids already, we get to do a baptism this morning. We get to have the honor of baptizing Nyla Kay Nakonda this morning, daughter of Cindy and Sabo. And so if you all want to come up front, we have a few questions for you. And what a significant day, Palm Sunday. It's just a celebration, so we're excited to have the honor to do this today. Brothers and sisters in Christ, through the sacrament of baptism, we are initiated into Christ's holy church. We are incorporated into God's mighty acts of salvation and given new birth through water and the Spirit. All this is God's gift, offered to us without price. I present Nyla Kay Nakonda for baptism.
Yeah, this is pretty awesome. Another great way to celebrate Holy Week with the baptism of a very sweet little girl. In the United Methodist Church, we baptize infants, babies, prior to the age when they can answer the questions of the faith for themselves. And then what we do is ask the parents, the mom, what if she will answer these questions for Nyla until Nyla can answer them for herself. And that will be at confirmation, which will be here before you know it, but when she's in sixth grade or seventh grade or so, in that range. Nyla, are you ready for this? She's like, We'll see. Okay, so here are the historic questions of the faith. On behalf of the whole church, I ask you that you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin. Do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? Do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in His grace, and promise to serve Him as your Lord, in union with the church which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? Will you nurture Nyla in Christ's holy church, that by your teaching and example she may be guided to accept God's grace for herself, profess her faith openly, and lead a Christian life?
All right. So I'm going to do a blessing over the water. Eternal God, the gift of water is a powerful symbol throughout Scripture. Pour out your Holy Spirit here and may this water empower, wash, cleanse, and be a reminder of grace and love throughout Nyla's life. All praise to you, Eternal Father, through your Son, Jesus Christ, who with you in the Holy Spirit lives and reigns forever. Amen.
Amen. Okay, I'm going to come on this side because she's the star of the show, and they want to see you and not my back. Hi, baby. Hi. Hi. So all these people are here for you. I'm going to put a little bit of water on your head, okay? It's a little bit chilly, but it's going to be awesome. You ready? By what name will we baptize this child? Nyla Kay, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and all of the people of God said together, Amen.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit work within you, that being born through water and the Spirit, you may remain always a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Members of the household of faith, I commend Nyla to your love and care, whom we this day recognize as a member of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that Nyla may grow in the knowledge and love of God through our Savior, Jesus Christ? We will so order our lives after the example of Christ, that Nyla, surrounded by steadfast love, may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so, little one.
precious. Let's welcome our newest member of Household of God. Good job. They're all clapping for you. Thank you.
I need to put these down because I don't have enough hands. All right. Well, during this season of Lent, we talk in children's time about how we are doing whatever we can to try and find ways to be closer to God. And one of the ways that we as a church community, as a congregation, have come together to try to be closer to God is by raising money for Heifer International. So we, at the beginning of Lent, gave out 236 jars that look like this. Many of them have already made their way back to us this morning. And then when we ran out of jars, we started encouraging people to just use whatever you have. So we have Ziploc bags, we have Tupperware, we have, I saw a giant cheese ball container filled with change. Our goal was to raise $5,000, and the $5,000 purchases an ark, which I have it written down because I knew I wasn't going to remember. The ark provides 2 water buffalo, 2 cows, 2 sheep, 2 goats, as well as bees, chicks, rabbits, and more. All the things that one community needs to have sustainable farming, food, clothing, anything that they need. So we are so excited to do our first ever, but hopefully not last, noisy offering today, where we are going to invite you to take all of your change jars or your Ziploc baggies or your Tupperware, whatever you have, and bring them down to the front. We have 2 metal pails, one here and one there, and then there are 2 in the balcony as well. Come on down in just a second, dump your change in, make as much noise as you can, because we want to hear the joy that that noise is going to bring to everybody. So we are going to invite you to come as you are able, but if maybe it's a little difficult for you to get to the front, or if it stresses you out and you don't really want to do it, raise your hand and flag us down, because guess what? I'm going to put Chris to work today, and I'm going to make him run down the aisles and grab your jars from you. I'm going to let Reagan have a break, though. She needs to rest. All right, so when our video begins, we invite you to come as you are able and put your change in our noisy offering.
Flashed across my fearless screen.
Okay, so if you didn't collect coins and you feel left out, folding money is fine. And these bins will be down here after the service as well. We will, of course, let you know via a church announcement how we did towards our goal. Heifer International really is a terrific ministry, and I'm proud of the church for supporting it. So in his second letter to the Corinthians, the Apostle Paul gives us a phrase that really does capture the heart of Christ's work. He says, "In Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself." Reconcile is a favorite word of Paul's. He uses it in his letter to the Romans. He uses it in his first letter to the Corinthians. He uses it here, of course, in his second letter to the Corinthians. In Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself. In Christian theology, this is known as the atonement. And as we begin Holy Week, it's our focus for today. This is the sixth and final Sunday in the season of Lent, a day that the church has traditionally called Palm Sunday because of the story we'll read here shortly, the story of Jesus' entrance into Jerusalem in the final days of his ministry. But today is actually also known as Passion Sunday, Christ's passion being that part of his story that begins with his last meal with his disciples and ends with his burial. We tell the story of Christ's passion on Maundy Thursday and Good Friday. And the church, and I'm talking about the capital C church here, the historical church, has always recognized this day as both Palm Sunday and Passion Sunday because, and I know you're going to find this hard to believe, not everyone comes to church on Maundy Thursday and Good Friday. It's true. Present company excluded, of course. In fact, when I was a kid growing up in the Roman Catholic tradition, we always read both the Palm and the Passion narratives every year on Palm Sunday, and that's actually an option in our Methodist tradition as well. Now, we're not going to be reading the Passion story this morning. We'll get to that part of the story of Christ on Thursday and Friday, but we are talking about an essential aspect of Christ's ministry that most people tend to associate with the end of his earthly life. Well, the atonement, as we'll see, is actually about more than just the cross. This is also the final week of our sermon series on Extraordinary Life, a Lenten journey with Jesus. We've been reading through the Gospel of Luke throughout this season, each week focusing on a different aspect of Christ's ministry. So far, we've talked about the temptation of Christ in the wilderness, his first sermon, his healing ministry, his teaching ministry, and his miracles. And as we pick up the story today near the end of the gospel, Jesus has journeyed to Jerusalem for the Passover, and we'll pick up the story from there. This is the lectionary reading for today, Luke 19, verses 28 to 40. So in the first two services, I did not point out ahead of time, kind of intentionally, but I thought maybe I should this time. So y'all are getting a special version of the sermon, just so y'all know. I don't know, that seems like a bigger deal to me than to y'all, but that's okay. There are two details in Luke's version of this story that we all associate with Palm Sunday that are missing. So just be watching for what those are. Listen, friends, for the word of God as it is proclaimed by God's servant, the evangelist Luke. After he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he had come near Bethphage and Bethany at the place called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples, saying, "Go into the village ahead of you, and as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it.' So those who were sent departed and found it as he had told them. As they were untying the colt, its owners understandably asked them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' They said, 'The Lord needs it.' Then they brought it to Jesus, and after throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. As he rode along, people kept spreading their cloaks on the road. As he was now approaching the path down from the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of the disciples began to praise God joyfully with a loud voice for all the deeds of power that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest heaven.' Some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, "Teacher, order your disciples to stop." He answered, "I tell you, if these were silent, the stones would shout out." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So the Gospels are clear that when Jesus arrives in Jerusalem, he arrives with great fanfare. While almost certainly there was no one in the crowd who fully understood exactly who he was or all that he had done, he nonetheless arrived in Jerusalem riding a wave of incredible popularity. And Luke makes it clear that the religious authorities were actually afraid to arrest him or harm him because of his popularity. We've spent the last 5 weeks, or the first 5 weeks of this sermon series, talking about just why it is the people are so captivated by him. He's been intentional about sharing the good news of God's love and forgiveness with everyone, especially with those on the margins of society. That's been a consistent theme in Luke. He has embodied a healing ministry that cares more about people than about the restrictions of the law. He's taught in a way that challenges us to be better than we otherwise would be, a teaching that both shapes our characters and transforms us. He's worked these incredible miracles on behalf of others, miracles that demonstrate the power of God working through him. He's been so captivating, so charismatic, so challenging and empowering and transformational that, as Luke will tell us in the reading we'll get to in just a few minutes, all the people were spellbound. So much has happened that has led to this moment of triumphant arrival in Jerusalem. So much has happened. So many lives have been touched. In stories recorded by the gospel, stories that have continued to touch lives for almost 2,000 years since. Writing a quarter of a century later, the Apostle Paul will say that in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself. What comes next in the days that follow our text for today is an important part of the story for sure, but it's good to remind ourselves that the coming days of Holy Week are just part of the story. Okay, so the unusual thing about Luke's version of the story, two details that are missing. Now, Luke is, without question, Christianity's greatest storyteller. Some of the most memorable moments in Jesus' life are found only in Luke's gospel. In fact, later this year, we're going to do a sermon series on Luke's greatest hits, talking about the stories from Jesus' life that only appear in Luke. I'm talking about the Good Samaritan, the prodigal son, Zacchaeus. I could go on and on. But did you notice the two details that are missing in his version? Well, first of all, there are no palms. That's kind of a big deal. Instead, Luke tells us that people laid their cloaks before him as he entered Jerusalem, but, you know, Cloak Sunday doesn't sound quite the same as Palm Sunday. I mean, I guess we could dress the kids, it would be like Harry Potter Sunday, they'd all be dressed in cloaks and coming down, blessed is, because the other thing is there's no word Hosanna in this version of the story, right? I mean, how different would our Palm Sunday music be if there was no, if we only had Luke's gospel, if we didn't have Hosanna? But despite the curious detail that Luke's missing two important details, the story of the entrance into Jerusalem still marks the beginning of the end of Christ's ministry. It's a ministry that will appear to all the world to end at the cross on Good Friday. So to return to our subject for today, atonement. This is a big deal for me in seminary. I spent a lot of time processing atonement theory. Atonement theory may not be your thing. If so, you can tune out a little bit, but stick around for the music later in the service. Like, don't go anywhere. Also, stick around for the offering. That's important. but for many people, atonement is really all about the cross. But did you know that there are actually many different atonement theories in Christian theology, that there are actually different understandings of just how it is that God reconciled the world to God's self in Christ. And did you further know that the church, and I'm talking about the Big C Church, the historical church, number one, has never settled on a single theory of the atonement, and number two, has never insisted that every Christian believe in any particular theory? That's true. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to do a review of all the atonement theories. That wouldn't be very interesting. My wife would have edited that out in the drafts of this sermon, I promise you. But I do want to talk about two. And the first one I want to talk about is the one I think most of us grew up with. I think most of us were taught this either overtly, depending on the tradition that we're in, or just really through cultural Christianity. And this is the theory that says that because of sin, humanity had a debt that it owed to God, right? Like here, all the world's sin is here. My sin, your sin, all of our sin collectively is on this side of the ledger. And the only thing that could have paid that debt was the death of God's one and only Son. It's a very kind of transactional approach to the atonement. And I'm sure that you're familiar with that theory. This is generally known as the substitutionary atonement theory, although there are variations that go by other names that are associated with various theologians throughout the centuries. And for me, this view of the atonement is kind of encapsulated in a famous verse of a hymn that I love. I love the hymn, "How Great Thou Art." It's been very important in my spiritual journey. And there's one line in a verse that says, "And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in." Now, there's certainly biblical warrant for this theory. It's an ancient theory. If it's meaningful to you, please hear me say, I am not trying to talk you out of it, if that's the way you understand the atonement. Millions of faithful Christians over the years, over the centuries, have understood the cross and the atonement in this particular way. But for me, that theory has always raised more questions than it answered. And if you feel the same way about that, we can go grab a cup of coffee and talk about it after Easter, but we can definitely go to get coffee and talk about it. So that in seminary, in my systematic theology class, when I learned that there have always been, and when I say always, I mean throughout the church's long history and even in the pages of Scripture itself, there have always been other ways to understand the atonement. It was very empowering for me, and I began to understand Holy Week in a different way. So we're going to come back to this, but there's one last piece of this story we need to read. This is Luke 19, verses 45 to 48. Then Jesus entered the temple and began to drive out those who were selling things there. And he said, "It is written, 'My house shall be a house of prayer,' but you have made it a den of robbers." Every day he was teaching in the temple. The chief priests, the scribes, and the leaders of the people kept looking for a way to kill him, but they did not find anything they could do, for all the people were spellbound by what they heard. Amen. Scholars believe that the cleansing of the temple was really the last straw for those who were threatened by Jesus' ministry. And, you know, any student of our salvation history would not be surprised by this. For all of our salvation history, prophets who challenge the status quo, prophets who confront those in power, prophets who want to reform systems that benefit the few at the expense of the many, they've always run the risk of being persecuted because of their message. And in the first century in particular, those who were perceived to have been a threat to Rome and Roman authority often met violent ends by Jesus cleansing the temple. That was a very public confrontation to the powers that be. Jesus' message, a message that we've been talking about throughout Lent, had been unambiguous from the beginning, that God's kingdom, God's love, God's grace, and God's forgiveness is intended for everyone. That for God, there are no outsiders. There are no outsiders for God. In his day, in Jesus' day, the outsiders were the poor, the sick, the sinner, the prisoner, the marginalized, the Gentile. it's such an inescapable foundation of his ministry that it's worth challenging ourselves, I think, as a religious leader, the one who usually was criticized by Jesus. This is not a minor thing. It's worth challenging ourselves, whoever we may think are outsiders, whoever we may view as needing to do things a different way. Well, those are probably the people Jesus would be inviting to dinner today, if his ministry today was like his ministry was in the first century. Jesus was constantly telling the religious leaders who thought they had it all figured out that in fact God's vision is broader than theirs. And he backed this up. He backed up his preaching and teaching with action. He was in fellowship with people the religious leaders thought that he should have avoided. He was welcoming to those whom society thought were better left outside. He healed and worked miracles on behalf of those whom so many deemed unworthy. That's what we've been talking about all season long. And the thing is, the crowds, the people, loved him for it. While the religious authorities were hell-bent on killing him for it. And on that first Palm Sunday, which I guess Luke would have had to call Cloak Sunday, which sounds very cool, both of those groups were there to greet him as he entered Jerusalem for the final time before his crucifixion. And ever since the momentous events of that first Holy Week, Christian theologians have developed lots of ways of thinking about just how it is that in Christ we are reconciled to God. Having spent a lot of time reading and thinking about this, the atonement theory that I find most meaningful, the one that resonates the most with me, is one that's called Christ the Victor. It's just as ancient as the other ones. It's a theory that says that through Jesus' extraordinary life, through all of it, through the incarnation of God in a baby born into poverty at the far edge of an empire that could not have cared less about his life, through a ministry that taught and healed and worked miracles on behalf of every child of God unconditionally, through a love that was willing to risk the cost of confronting the powers that be in a world consumed with sin, through an unjust execution in a barbaric manner by an empire that sought to rule through fear and terror, and through the end of the story that we get to tell next week, which is to say, through his life and his ministry and his death and his resurrection, through all of it, Christ in a mysterious way conquered the powers of sin and evil and suffering and death once and for all. And in doing so, he empowered us to live spirit-filled and grace-filled lives. And through that mystery, Christ reconciled to God all who put their faith in him. It took every bit of this extraordinary life to do that. Now the thing is, as our professors in seminary reminded us over and over again, ultimately, every theory about just how God affects the atonement offers us just a partial understanding. What matters most, of course, is that Christ reconciles us to God. The how has been explained in many ways through the centuries. But no metaphor or analogy is precise. All theories of human explanation are simply human attempts to explain God, which is a terribly pretentious, if necessary, task. Having said all that, there is one more analogy on my mind as we wrap up this series, especially at this moment in world history. You know, last week we discovered, the world discovered, evidence of Russian atrocities in Ukraine. And, you know, if you follow the news, as I'm sure all of you do, we're seeing this rise of totalitarianism around the world. And if history is any guide, totalitarianism inevitably brings with it manifestations of evil and suffering and death. especially as an American, I think of World War II, when troops were sent to Europe and to the Pacific to save the world from fascism. If ever there was a just war, then surely ending the atrocities of the Holocaust and the tyranny of fascism would certainly qualify. And in such a conflict, the deaths of those who are sent to fight are an inevitability. In some cases, the deaths of those who are sent to fight are a certainty. But of course, the dying is not the point. The dying is the tragic consequence of a commitment to a greater cause in a world broken by sin and evil and suffering. D-Day, June 6, 1944, marked the beginning of the end of the war in Europe as 156,000 Allied soldiers landed in enemy territory by land and by sea and by air. It was, of course, a dangerous and, of course, a necessary step. And in his radio address to the nation that day, President Roosevelt said this: "They fight not for the lust of conquest. They fight to end conquest. They fight to liberate." More than 4,000 men would not survive the day, making the ultimate sacrifice to save the world from tyranny. But it was a decisive moment, and the war in Europe would end with Germany's unconditional surrender 11 months later. Now look, it's an imperfect analogy, of course, as are all theories and metaphors for the mystery of God's work in the world. But it seems to me that this one is pretty close to the notion of Christ the victor. The willingness of God to go to the cross in order to liberate us from the sin and the suffering and the evil and the death in the world. These days, after having thought about it quite a bit, when I sing "How Great Thou Art," and I do love that hymn, I reinterpret that memorable line in my head. And when I think that God, his Son, not sparing, sent him to save me and you, I scarce can take it in. Friends, Holy Week is the culmination of the story of this extraordinary life that saves us all. All that's asked of us is to put our faith in him. I hope you'll join us on Thursday night and Friday night as we hear the rest of the story that it takes to get to Easter Sunday. Amen.
We now come to our time for prayers of the people. Before we pray, just a note that the flowers in our sanctuary this morning are given in honor of Eleanor Normand on her birthday by Michael, Sam, and Noah Kerner. Also, a reminder, you can always submit a prayer online at cumc.com/prayer and on our chapel prayer wall. Our prayer ministry team will be honored to lift up your requests every day. And now, after each prayer is read, I invite you to respond with the words, "Lord, hear our prayer." So let us go to God in prayer now. God of all, as we give thanks for your lordship and for the salvation you offer to each of us on this Palm Sunday, we ask that you would empower us to be witnesses of your love and grace to a world in need. Help us to show others that they are all your beloved children, no matter who they are or where they come from. Lord, hear our prayer. We pray for those who continue to be affected by violence, both here in our country and around the world, especially those in Ukraine who are still facing the devastation of war. God, be with them and grant them your peace, and to peace to all the victims of hatred and evil wherever they are, and help us to offer your comfort and hope to them. Lord, hear our prayers. We continue to remember and pray for those who are facing and struggling with physical, emotional, relational, or spiritual challenges. God, help them know that they are never alone in their struggles, but that you are with them every day, as are their families and their friends and the church. Lord, hear our prayers. We pray all these things in Jesus' holy name, who taught us all to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We come now to the time where we uplift our tithes and offerings, but again, we're so glad you're worshiping with us this morning, whether you're in person or if you're joining us online, and we want to know that you're here. So there's a few ways to do that. If you're in person, you can scan the QR code on the back of your bulletin. There are also some cards with a blue line at the back of your pew that you can fill out and put those in the offering plate as it passes by. If you're online from Facebook, you can simply like or comment. If you're watching from the website, you can sign in. So I love being a Methodist for so many reasons, but one thing that I particularly love is how we can be outwardly focused, that we know that we have a call to go out into the world and to tell others about who Christ is and to really put our hands and feet to work. And I think this morning is a wonderful example as we collected change for Heifer International that will serve communities that we will never probably see. We will never know those people, but we know that it's part of our calling to take care of people and to help transform lives. Also, for the last several weeks, we had been collecting money for our connection to Poland. As we've gone over to Poland, we have a friend and pastor there, and we've raised around $85,000, and we have sent that. And this was a quote that he sent to us, in case you can't read it. "Thank you for your prayer and solidarity with Ukraine and us in Poland. Thank you for collecting this donation, which will help us in many matters we are carrying out here. This support from you for the most important needs allows us to carry out our Methodist work with refugees. God bless you all." So I thank you for your generosity, the way that you continue to respond to the needs around, knowing that so much of what we do doesn't go just stay here in our local church, but goes out in our community, but across the world. So thank you for your generosity, the ongoing generosity, and the examples that you set. So thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you. I invite you to remain standing as you're able and join in our closing hymn, number 160, Rejoice, Ye Pure in Heart.
Please be seated. So that is just a warm-up for the celebration for next week. Easter is going to be spectacular, and I look forward to seeing you all next week. If you have decided that today is the day you want to take the next step in your spiritual journey, as you leave the sanctuary today, there's a Get Connected table right in front of you. There's a staff member there who can answer questions for you about the United Methodist Church or about Christ United, or offer you the vows of membership or get you connected in any other way that you need to be connected. The thing about Holy Week is it's kind of the saddest part of, it's not kind of, it is the saddest part of the story. And yet, we know that Easter is just right around the corner. And so I love that the church throughout the centuries has held in tension the celebration of his entry in Jerusalem, but knowing that Friday is coming. As people of faith, though, we can rejoice, like that last hymn says, because we know, number one, that Easter is coming, and number two, that in Christ we are reconciled to God. So as we make the journey for these last few days before Easter, may we go in the grace and peace of our Lord. Amen.